an all-time Christian, an all-time Christian, a believer who is a believer at all times, because life and the scriptures has taught us that seasons will change, times will change, many things will change, people will change, times will change, seasons will change. And in order for us to cope with the change of times, with the change of seasons, without compromising our stance and our belief system, there are certain things we need to know. But before then, we want to read from Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. We read 3 verses, verse 16, 17, and 18. An all-time Christian. An all-time Christian. An all-time believer. Let's join in reading even from our homes. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful. We are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. Now verse 18, very important. It captures our message. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Let's go back to verse 17 again. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able. We know him. He is able to deliver us. He has the choice to deliver us. We believe in him. We know him. He will deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But then they go to another side of life. They are trying to tell the king, we are not believers in one time. We are not believers in certain times, and some other times we are not. We become something else. But if not, if God decides not to save us, but it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, we are not going for the other option. We are believers when God saves us. We are also believers if he doesn't save us. We are believers when things are good. We are also believers when things are not good. We don't believe only when things are good. We don't only believe God when he is saving us, when he is doing good things to us. We are all time believers. We are not believers of certain times. We don't believe God certain times. We believe God all the time. When the season change, we are the same believers. When seasons are good, when it is time for good things, we are still believers. When things are not good, we still believe the same. Please, I want us to know that your God, the God that you serve, is an all-time God. He is an all-time God. Your God is an all-time God. Therefore, you are supposed to be imitators of God. If he is the God of all time, we need to be believers in him of all time. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is an all-time God. Nothing changes him. Seasons come and go. He doesn't change God. Things come our God, please note this, the God that you believe in, the God that is your God, the God that saved you, is an all-time God. Nothing changes him. Nothing makes him look different than he is. And nothing will ever be able to change him. He is the same yesterday. If things were good yesterday, he is the same. And things are bad today, he is the same. He is, and your God is an all-time God. All the same, is the same. Your God is an all-time God. Therefore, you should be an all-time believer in him. And there are two major seasons in our lives. If I may put it that way, there are two major seasons, or there are two major times. Actually, mainly, there are two times in our lives: the time of challenges and the times of success. The time of bad things, the times of problems, and the times of success. There are two seasons in our lives. There are two times in our lives when things are doing well and when things don't seem to be doing well. The times of challenges and the time of success. Those are the two seasons of mankind, of human beings. No matter how many years you live on earth, you will always experience those two times. And today I'm going to dwell very much on the times of challenges, because the times of, listen to this, this is very important. The times of challenges is the primary cause for the success life. It is like you can't go to high school, you can't go to the university until you go through the primary school. So the time of the challenge is the pre-moment to our success season. And the way you do in your primary season, what that your performance in primary school determines how far you go, how you handle the moment that will come after that. It determines what high school you will go. It determines whether you will go to the university or not. So the moment of challenge, the seasons of challenge, the time of challenge is our primary school to determine our future, to determine how we handle our future. In terms of preparation, in terms of destiny, God achieves more with the challenges than with the success. In terms of destiny preparation, God achieves more with the challenges. God achieves more with the challenges than with the success. Success cannot prepare you for future. It is challenges that prepares you for the life ahead. It is what we go through that seems contrary, that seems opposite our beliefs, that prepares us for the life ahead. There are three major reasons why God brings success to us. I want us to compare what God achieves through success and what God achieves through challenges, and then we will capitalize on the challenges for today, and then maybe next time we'll be able to look at the success. Now, success has three major things that God wants to achieve in our lives through it. God makes us successful, number one, that we may glorify him. Remember, we are the image of God, and therefore success in our lives becomes a face. It becomes a face to the world. Just to make an announcement, you see, this is what happens. This is what happens to they that fear him. This is what happens to they that seek him. Success glorifies God. When people see what God in your life. When people see what God has done in your life, the first thing that happens, the first thing that God achieves out of that is glory for his name. Number two, God blesses us, God causes us to succeed so that we may serve him better. It is for his service. God does not bless us just for ourselves. It's for his service, because it is only his service that has eternal value. It is only what we do for God that goes with us beyond the grave. So God makes us success. God allows and brings success to us so that we may effectively serve him. And number three, God causes us to succeed so that we may live a godly life, so that we may live a good life, so that we may enjoy our lives. God is a good father. He loves to see his children enjoy life. He is a good father. Remember when the disciples of Jesus came to Jesus and told them, teach us how to pray. He said, when you pray, pray like this: our Father who is in heaven. Not our God, our Father. So God, in relating to us, his children, he is a father, not just a God. God is a God to the universe, but he is a father to his children. He is a God to everybody. He is a God even to the animals. He is a God to every human being, whether good or evil. He is God. But to they that know and believe in Jesus and have accepted Jesus, he is a father. He said, when you pray, pray like this: our Father in heaven. So God, being a father, he is not like our earthly fathers. He is a good, reliable father. He is excited when his children enjoy life. And I speak to anyone that is hearing us now and in the future, God wants you to enjoy life. God does not want you to endure life. He wants you to enjoy life. He is a good father. First Timothy chapter 6 and verse 17. Charge them that are rich in this world that they may not be, they be not high minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. He gives us things. He makes us successful. He blesses us that we may enjoy his children. That we may enjoy. He gives us things richly in abundance that we may enjoy. These are the three major things that God achieves through our success. But please listen to this. Whether success or challenges, the devil wants to use it for our disadvantage. That is very important. That is very important for any believer to note, that whether you are successful, the enemy will come after you to try and use success against you and against God. It is success that made Solomon to miss out with God. Solomon was not dealing with poverty. Solomon was not dealing with sicknesses. He was not dealing with lack of money or lack of honor or lack of anything good. It was because of his success that he missed out with God. If the enemy given an opportunity, he can, as a matter of fact, he uses success against us more easily than challenges. And every believer needs to hear this, because especially in these days, many Christians, when they are blessed, they don't know that the enemy can use the very blessing to turn grant them the very blessing that God has given them to turn to, he can use it to turn their backs against God, to turn the success against themselves. It is when the kingdom of David was quiet and peaceful that David was left at home enjoying himself when the kings got to war, and that was the beginning of bad things in the life of David. It was during success that great, because success is so easy to make people slide, because failing from success is just going downwards. It's just going downwards. You don't need effort to go down, you need effort to go up. That's why the Bible says, how has the mighty fallen. How did the people who were high, mighty, powerful, anointed, graced, blessed, how did they fall? It's because some of them were not aware that whether you are successful, whether you are dealing with success or dealing with the challenge, the enemy would want to use any of them. Why? Success can take you places that God does not want you to be, simply because you are able to go. Success can buy you things that you don't need, things that will become poison to you. If you look at the temptation, when the devil came to tempt Jesus, he knew Jesus is a great man, he can do one of the temptations of great men is to just, he told them, just drop yourself, the angels will take care of you. What does that mean? The temptation of success is to be careless. Just drop yourself, the angels will take care of you. Just drop yourself, just be careless. That is the temptation of great men. That is the temptation of successful people. That is how the enemy twists success to fight against those who have it. Just drop yourself, the angels will take care of you. Just drop yourself. Drop yourself. Be careless. Bow, just bend, just bow, just bow. Twist yourself. You are already powerful. You can do anything. You can bow to Satan today and bow to God tomorrow. Why don't you just bow, just in a short moment? You are already great, and I want to give you all these kingdoms and the glory thereof. Just bow. You can bow, you are powerful. You can bow to Satan today and bow to God tomorrow. It's the temptation of being careless, and you think you can do anything and still go on. Jesus said, we should not tempt the Lord. My point is this. Let's go to verse 11. Let's see something here as we move on. And in their hands, verse 10. For it is written. Let's look at verse 8. Let's start from verse 8 so that we get the concept. And Jesus answered and said to him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Verse 9. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle. Successful people are on top. They are on top of life. He took him to the top and said to him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. Just drop yourself. Just drop yourself. If you are what you say you are, the temptation of great is to prove themselves, is to prove what they already are. The devil wanted Jesus to prove himself by being careless. Many people, when they become very successful, it is so easy to become careless in life, careless in our character, careless in our behavior, because that is the way for the enemy to use success against us. Great men in the Bible that failed is because of this. Samson is another example. He did not fail because he was a poor man in the village. He failed because he was a powerful man. He can play with this woman today and play with another one tomorrow and play with the other one tomorrow, and the anointing is still there, and the temptation is just be careless, drop yourself, you will be taken care of, nothing will go wrong, things will be okay. Drop yourself, you will still continue preaching, the anointing will still manifest. Just be careless, just be careless. Cast thyself down. It is carelessness to drop yourself down, even if you are sure you will be taken care of. You are casting yourself down for no reason. There is nothing you are achieving. Nobody achieves anything positive by carelessness. Look at Satan. He's telling Jesus, just drop yourself. What is he dropping himself for? There is nothing that Jesus will achieve. Jesus will not become more than he is by dropping himself, by being careless. But it is a tool of Satan. So whether you are successful, whether you are in your season of success or in the season of challenge, the enemy will use either of them. God reminded the children of Israel, when you eat and you are full, be careful, because there is an enemy coming after you because of success. There are temptations that are specifically tailored and waiting for people in their success seasons. There are some challenges, there are some temptations that cannot come to you when you are in certain levels of life. They are waiting for you when you are on top. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God. He tells them, when you eat and you are a fool, when you build good houses, when your flock increases, when your gold and silver increases, be careful. There is an enemy that is after you during your success seasons. I wish believers would know this. We wouldn't be losing brothers and sisters the way we are losing in Pentecostal circles today. They were very prayerful. They were anointed. They were seeking God when they were struggling, when in their seasons of challenges. But in the seasons of their success, they give up. They give up to the enemy, and the enemy takes over their lives. That is what is happening in the body today, especially in the charismatic movement, that we seek God, we pray, we are there during the seasons of challenges, but when God takes the challenges away and then moves us to the next level, we did not know that there is an enemy that was waiting for us in the seasons of success. So we become cheap prey to the enemy. An all-time Christian, you must understand certain things in the systems of God and of his kingdom. You must understand how he operates and how his kingdom operates. If you don't understand the way God operates, if you don't understand the way the kingdom of God operates, you will be a seasonal Christian. You will be asking questions you shouldn't be asking. must understand the way God and His kingdom operates. And today, briefly, with the remaining time, I want us to look at why challenges are very, very important to balance you as a Christian of all times. It is challenges that balances our lives. It is challenges that brings balance. That's why anyone that God ever used in the Bible or in history, they were men and women that had gone through challenges to balance. Because if you have gone through challenges successfully, you will go through the moment of praises successfully. If you have never gone through challenges, when they praise you, they dislocate your life. Because praises should come where there has been challenges. When praises come where there has never been challenges, destruction is very close. That's why Jesus himself, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews, that we don't have the high priest that cannot be touched by our feelings. That is to say, he had to go through pain so that when we talk about pain to him, he understands. He had to go through challenges so that when we come to him crying because of our challenges, he understands what we are talking about. Our high priest went through what men go through so that he may be able to be an effective high priest. A shepherd cannot be a good shepherd if he doesn't understand the problems and the challenges of the flock. So, I'm trying to show you that whether you are in your season of success or your season of challenges, because those seasons will keep coming. They keep coming. They don't stop. They only stop when you stop growing or when you die. They keep changing. Today is the season of challenge. Tomorrow, we have a season of success. When God wants to change our level, he allows certain challenges to come. And when we graduate from those challenges, we go to another season of success. And then after some time, when the season of that level of success expires, he allows some challenges again that will prepare us for the next level of success. And life goes like that in cycles. Life is not a straight line. And in all this process, the enemy is looking for an opportunity, whether your season of success or your season of challenges. He will always use any one of them. And I don't want to get back to that. I don't want to go that way. I want us to look at the God's perspective or the system of God when it relates to challenges and believers. How does the system of God operate? How does the kingdom of God function and operate when we talk about challenges? Number one, challenges is a part of the process of building you. It's a part. Remember, building your life as a strong Christian is a process. And in that process, challenges is a part of it. We are not not born into success. We are built for success. We are developed for success. You can't live a life you have not been developed for. You can't live a life you have not been prepared for. Even God says, for what no eye has seen, no ear has heard, is what God has prepared. Before you get to a prepared blessing, you must be prepared yourself. Your personal preparation is as important as the preparation of the blessing. Many people that got into blessings that were prepared, and they were not preparing themselves, the blessing turned against them. That's what happens when you get into a level or a blessing without being prepared. You need to ask yourself, from 12 years when we hear about Jesus in the temple, for the next 18 years, where was Jesus? The ministry of Jesus was to last only for 3.5 years. But in order for him to have impact in those 3.5 years, he had to be prepared himself. And one of the ways of preparation into what God had already prepared for him was to go through challenges, insults, difficulties, rejection, right from his own family. James 1, let's move faster now. James 1, verse 2 to 4. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Give us NIV. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. That's an apostle talking. Apostle James, the one who brought balance in the church of the apostles, is the apostle that brought the balance between faith and behavior. He said you can't have faith that is not matching the behavior. Now here he is trying to bring balance to believers, and he is saying, don't consider it, don't, you should always consider it joy when you go through challenges. Let's call it that way for now. Let's, when we go through all many kinds of challenges. And he is trying also to suggest to us that no matter how good you are, challenges will come. Challenges only stop when you stop growing. Challenges only stop when you stop living. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Let's go on. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. If God were to develop you, if God were to prepare you, challenges is a part of the process. We know, even in this natural life, any kind of training must have challenges. If you are trained to become a soldier, your training is different from that one of a teacher. But the common denominator in every training is that there is some level of pain and sacrifice. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Your faith cannot be developed without challenges. It's challenges that develops your faith. It is challenges that develops your character. You cannot become a stable, strong Christian by good things happening to your life alone. Challenges is a part of development process of a believer.
So it is necessary.
Let's look at verse 4. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. No perfection, no maturity without challenges. It is not the blessing that matures you, it is the challenges that matures you. First Peter, let's look at First Peter also. 4, verse 12. First Peter. Dear friends, I like this one. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. Apostle Peter is saying, challenge should not be strange. You should not be surprised when you go through challenges. Actually, you should be surprised when there are no challenges. As a believer of all time, when there are no challenges, you should ask, what is happening in my life? Am I in the right track? Am I doing the right thing? Is my life moving the right direction? This is the kind of messages that the Christianity of today is lacking. We allow ourselves to be carried away by success and prosperity gospel, and that is good. Prosperity is good, success is good, but it is only balanced by the challenges that we go through. Dear friends, do not be surprised. Let's look at King James. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange things happened unto you. So challenges are not strange. It's a part of development process, building process of a believer, in order for you to become a Christian of all time. So that when challenges come, you are already built for it. You have been developed for it. Number two, challenges is a part of process of producing the glory of God in your life. Glory of God is manufactured, and one of the ingredients of manufacturing the glory of God is challenges. One of the ingredients of manufacturing, preparing the glory of God in your life is challenges. Challenge, glory is not a gift. Glory is not an impartation. It's something that is manufactured. It's something that comes because of a process. A person, if you were to ever manifest the glory of God, you must go through a process, and at the end, the product is glory. Let's look at Romans 8, verse 17 and 18. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so, this is important, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. If you don't share in the challenges of life, you cannot share in the glory of Christ. If you run away from the challenges, you are running away from the glory. If we suffer with him and for him, then we qualify to carry his glory. Let's also look at 2 Corinthians 4. Okay, let's finish verse 18.
is where the real thing is.
Verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings, not blessings. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Not for us, in us. If you want to see the glory of God in your life, don't count strange when challenges come your way. It's a part of it. It's a part of the process to manufacture, to produce the glory of God in your life. For I reckon that the sufferings of this, let's look at how NIV is putting it. I consider that our present sufferings are not worthy comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. It is the challenges that exposes and reveals and manufactures the glory of God in us. It is like wine. No matter how long you stay with the fruits, they can never turn into wine until they are crushed, until they are pressed. Challenges presses the glory of God out of us. Men of God, you want to carry the anointing? You should not be complaining about challenges. If you are complaining about challenges, then you are missing an opportunity for the glory of God to manifest in your life. Number three, challenges is a part of the vetting process of God. Is a part of the vetting process of God. God does not trust people for free. God must vet you. You must be vetted by God in order for Him to trust you. Before He can give you a lot of money, He must vet you to see how you will behave when you have a lot of money. Before He can trust you with a lot of anointing, you must go through His vetting and He must accredit you. God does not trust people. God, listen to this. God loves people for free, but God does not trust people for free. He loved us when we were yet sinners, but He did not trust us when we were yet sinners. Trust is earned when we go through challenges. The Bible shows us in Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2 and 3. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you. There was not an accident. There was a shortcut that they could have taken 11 days, but God said, I have not, for where I am taking you, the land of milk and honey, I must vet you for it. I cannot just jump you there. You must go through a process to earn that kind of atmosphere. God led you all the way. It is God who led them through the wilderness to humble you and to test you. Look at that. And to test you in order to know. God want to know. The God that knows everything, He still want to know whether He can trust you. To test you in order to know what was in your heart. Whether or not you would keep His commands. Look at verse 3. This is good. He humbled you, causing you to anger.
It is God that caused them to go angry.
Now I see why they were complaining. Kwa sababu njaa yao haikuwa natural, haikuwa biological. The Bible is saying, and God caused you to anger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. So God is saying, I allowed you to go through the dangerous route, where there was no water, where there was no food, where there were snakes, dangerous snakes. It was not a coincidence. It was my program for vetting you to see what is in your heart. I want them to see whether I can trust you with the land of Canaan. And it turned out that you cannot be trusted. It is only your children that will get there. Because whatever God has prepared for you, if you don't agree with him so that he may prepare you, he will preserve, he will keep his thing for others that he can trust. You can't be a Christian of all time if God has not vetted you. And how does he vet you? Challenges. He will deliberately, wakati mwingine unapitia mambo ambayo watu walio karibu nawe wanaweza kukusaidia, lakini Mungu anawazuia wasikusaidie ili aone ni nini iko kwa roho yako. Yani ni shida ambayo mtu anaweza kutatua na dakika tatu, lakini Mungu anawaambia don't. Sometimes even unforgiveness, sometimes even unforgiveness and settling down matter is necessary. Ya kisi ambayo ingeisha tu haraka haraka, Mungu anasema hii sitaki ishe haraka, kwa sababu kupitia hii case nitajua ni nini iko. I will vet you. Can you imagine what would have happened? Can you imagine what would have happened if Pharaoh alipogundua Moses ni deliverer na siku moja atakuja kuokoa wana wa Israeli? Can you imagine if Pharaoh said, Moses, can we settle this matter so that you don't have to run away, just stay, we will see what will happen with this case. Moses would have lived in Egypt and never become, he would have become the next Pharaoh. But he was not created to become Pharaoh. He was created to become, can you imagine what would have happened if the husband, if a Potiphar came home and was told by the wife, Joseph, this your servant wanted to rape me. And the man said, okay, Joseph, we forgive you. We see what happens next. Joseph will never have become the prime minister in Egypt. Challenges is a part of the vetting process of God for trust. God wants to see how you will behave when he gives you a lot of money. God wants to see how you will behave when God makes you famous. When God makes you a powerful man, he wants to see now before you become. He wants to know how you will behave then before you get there. Joseph knew it, and he told his brothers, you wanted to harm me, but God was preparing me so that things can be the way they are today. I have been vetted. I can't revenge. God can trust me with power because he knows I will not attack those who oppose me. I will not attack those who have a different opinion. I have been vetted. I am not where I am by accident. It was not good luck. I did it. I did the exam and passed successfully. When you get to a level through the vetting of God, even the devil himself cannot bring you down. You have been vetted. The position of Jesus has no one to contend with it today, because Jesus went through the vetting process. curses, being insulted, being called names, being called a bastard, the son of a woman, or all these things, dying on the cross, it was a part, being spit on his face, being mocked. You are the son of God, you are saving others, now can you save yourself? All these things, God allowed Jesus to go through them as a vetting process. And the Bible says, and today God has given him a name that is highly exalted. He has exalted him and given him a name that is above. When you are given a name or a position through the vetting of God, it remains. It stays throughout the seasons of life. He was vetted. You must be vetted. God must vet you and accredit you. When men accredit you, they will take away the credit tomorrow. When God vets you, it remains. It is a vetting process. He said, I allowed you to go through anger deliberately. Niliwapeleka ile njia mrefu deliberately. Niliwapeleka mahali hakuna maji na hakuna chakula deliberately. Niliwapitishia a long cut, not shortcut. There was a shortcut, but I avoided shortcut for you. Because when you go too, when your journey is too short, you don't learn a lot of things. In 40 years, they had learned the ways of God. God said no to shortcut. Where are we now? Number 4. Challenge is a part of God's training process for success. It's a part of training process. Training is not a one-day thing. Any training that is one day, its impact will only be one day. God wanted a generational impact in the ministry of Jesus. It took him 18 years to be trained. Number 5. Challenges authenticate your victory and authority as a believer. Challenges authenticate. It is challenges that you go through that shows that your victory and your authority is legitimate. When you see somebody saying be blessed and it just happens, there is something that authenticates his authority and the way he is operating. Paul the apostle wanted some people to know why he has the authority that he has as an apostle. And some people were arguing and asking, who gave you this authority? Who gave you this position that you are trying to operate in? And in Galatians chapter 6, the apostle Paul is trying to tell them where the authority of an apostle is coming from. Galatians 6 in verse 17. Finally, I am just enjoying my message. Finally, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body, not in the spirit, on my body the marks of Christ. I have suffered for my position. I have suffered for the victories that I have. I have suffered. I have it. If you want a proof, the proof is the mark in my body. The things I have gone through, the challenges I have overcome, that is what authenticates my authority. You see, when Jesus died and rose again, one of the things that God did not do is that God, though he was able, he never took away the marks of the nails. When Jesus resurrected, he resurrected with the holes. Until today they are there. And when they were doubting, he came one
day, and he told them, you know, I'm the one who died and rose again. And Thomas said, I can't believe. Jesus did not argue with Thomas. He showed him the scars. It is the proof of my authority. It authenticates who I say that I am. If you get a position by going through challenges and fighting the battles that you went to fight, you become a man of authority without argument. You don't have to argue. Finally, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. Nobody should trouble me. Anybody that is asking questions, just look at the marks. If you want to know where I got the power from and the authority, don't look at my sermons. Anybody can preach, but it is not anybody that can allow the marks. Anybody can prepare a sermon, but there are few people who can die. There are few people who will go through bad things without complaining. Now let me close. These are some of the things that will help you when you go through challenges, in order for you to become an all-time Christian. Number one, you must have personal convictions of biblical truths. Personal convictions. From biblical truths. Personal convictions. Romans, let's move fast. Our time is gone. 5 more minutes and then we are done for this service. Romans 8, verse 38 and verse 39. For I am convinced, not I am thinking, I am convinced that neither death nor life. You see the two seasons? Neither death nor life. Neither angels nor demons. Neither the present nor the future. Nor any powers. Neither height nor depth. Nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That is a conviction. Where are we read in the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, they were convinced on certain things about God. They said, the God that we know, the God that we serve, is able to save us. And if he doesn't save us, we have a conviction he is still God. He is still our God. We will still stand for him. Nothing will change that. That is the truth. He is a good God. That is the truth. He is a powerful God. That is the truth. He is a good God. That is the truth. People change with the seasons because they don't have well-founded convictions. Convictions. Number two, the assurance of the presence and the involvement of God in your life. The assurance. The assurance of the presence of God and the involvement of God in your life. Isaiah 43 and verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. God is very interesting. I want you to know, this is a very important truth that every believer must know, that God is very interesting. Sometimes he will not save you from the fire. He will not put put off the fire, but he will come to be with you in the fire. Very interesting. Sometimes he will not dry the waters, he will just come to be with you in the waters. Sometimes he will not save you from the valley of death, he will come to be with you in the valley of death. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for God is with me. I am passing through the valley of death, but God did not save me from the valley, but he will be with me in the valley. Very interesting. I kept wondering for many years, why would God wait? Why would God wait? Conspiracy inafanywa. Inawekwa kwa sheria. Moto inatengenezwa. All these things zilitaji preparations. Moto inatengenezwa. Moto inaongezwa 7 times. Na Mungu afanye chochote kuokoa hawa watu. Paka naongojea wanafungwa. Wanapewa second opportunity, wanakataa. Wakati wanatupwa kwa moto ndio wanaingia kuwa na wao kwa moto. Kwa sababu gani? Kwa sababu Mungu akikuja awe na wewe kwa challenge, it will speak louder than when he would have saved you from the challenge. People will see him. Ukio challenge ikizuiwa, ile ilikuwa inakuja izuiwe isikufikie, hakuna watu watajua. Lakini challenge ikikuja na usurvive hiyo challenge, watu wataona Mungu. Why would he say when you go through the fire? That means he will wait sometimes until you get into the fire, then he comes. He will allow you sometimes to get into the water. He will do nothing before, then he comes into the water. That is our God. That is what makes him God. Please understand, sometimes God will not save you from trouble. He will be with you in the trouble. Sometimes God will not save you from dangers. He will be with you in the danger. That is how he works. David said, when I'm looking at death, I will not be afraid, because even when I'm looking at death, you are with me. That assurance is very important. That is why the last statement Jesus left with us is, behold, I am with you. Not I shall be with you. I am with you. And listen to this. This is important. You can write it down. This is very important. The presence of challenges does not mean the absence of God. The presence of challenges does not mean the absence of God. Many people misinterpret. They think, they say, if God is with me, why, where is God? Where is God? I can't see God. I can't see God. You don't see God by what he does. You see God through the assurance. Behold, I am with you. When he was sending Moses to Egypt, he told him, Moses, I know you are a stammerer, and I will not even change your mouth. You will very interesting. You know I am a stammerer, and you are sending me to speak on your behalf, and you don't change my stammering. Then you tell me, behold, I will be with your mouth. What kind of a God is this? I will be with your mouth. You know, saying when you begin talking, I will change your stammering. No. When the stammerer delivers a will see God. But when a stammerer is changed into an orator, people will not see God. When God takes a weak person like you and he makes you a great man, a great woman, people will see God and glorify him. When Paul went to pray, Bible scholars have a lot of argument around the thorn that Paul was talking about. He said, I went to pray 3 times that God may take away this thorn in my flesh. But God refused to remove the thorn. And he said, my grace is sufficient. Because when you are weak, then you are strong. What kind of confusion is this? When you are weak, then you qualify for the strength of God. When you are not able, then you qualify for the ability of God. The assurance of the presence and the involvement of God in your life. Number three, the understanding that challenges are not permanent. That is what many Christians forget. Your challenge is not permanent. No matter how tough it is, always remind yourself that your challenge is not permanent. 2 Corinthians 4:17. Thank you, Jesus. For our light and momentarily. Let's see how King James is putting it. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. No challenge that is permanent. No trouble that is permanent. Every challenge has an expiry date. Every trouble has a deadline. Every problem has an expiry date. Don't let your challenges push you to make permanent decisions based on challenges that are not permanent. For our light affliction, that is for a moment. No challenge that is forever. That understanding is crucial. Number four, the understanding that through challenges, God is developing you for a better and admirable future. And I want to tell you something. I'm helping you. This is a very important statement. Anyone today that does not have the discernment to see where God is taking you, he is not supposed to be with you on the road. Anyone that cannot have the discernment to see where God is taking you in future, you should not walk with that person to the future. Because the only person that should walk to you, should walk with you to the glorious future, is the person that sees your glorious future and ignores the challenges you are going through today. Anybody that is not ready to suffer with you should not share in the glory with you in the future. If you have not suffered with me, don't share the glory with me. The understanding that by the challenges I'm going through, God is developing a better and a glorious future for me by the challenge. Because challenges are God's tools. Anyone that cannot discern the future that God is taking you should not be with you on the road, on the journey in the first place. And finally, you will need endurance and patience. If you will be a Christian, an all-time Christian, there is no shortcut. Some challenges will take some time, so you will have to wait. Success is not an overnight thing. You will have to wait, even when things are not the way you want them to be. A colored future will need some more time to fix it. You will have to wait. Our today's generation does not understand the language of waiting. It's an instant generation. We want glory without process. We want success without challenges. We want glory without waiting. But I can tell you, many things that are attractive will require some waiting. No normal baby will be born after 3 months of conception. It's not a normal baby. If you want the baby to be born normally, you must wait for 9 months of discomfort. 9 months. Nothing comes normally without waiting, without patience. The Bible says in Matthew 24, in the midst of many things, verse 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. When I was reading this scripture, the Lord dropped something in my heart. Endurance simply means making your skin tough. That's what endurance is. You make your skin tough. If you come back to Wakikundunga, you are still moving. You are not feeling it. If you come back, they are criticizing what you are building, and you continue building. Your skin has become like the one for crocodile, too tough. You can't be stopped. I am praying for you that God will help you to thicken your skin, to toughen your skin, because there will be many arrows. There will be many arrows. There will be attacks. There will be disloyalty. You will be betrayed. You will be pierced from behind and from front. You need a tough skin. You need a thick skin. Tukisoma hiyo Matthew, I think verse 12, inatuambia because the wickedness will be too much, many people will fall from their faith. Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall grow cold, because their skin was not tough. If you want to be a believer of all time, you must toughen your skin. You must make your skin tough. If you kwamba unakuta watu wanaongea mambo yako na ikuingi, you go on with your life. Unakuta watu walikuwa wanakungossip, unawambia, you can continue. I also want to hear it without being offended, because your skin has become tough. He that endures to the end shall be saved. Tough skin. Hebrews 6 verse 11 and 12, and then we close.
Yes, we honor you. We give you glory, Lord.
And we desire that every one of you, not some of us, every one of you, do shew the same day.
diligence to the full assurance of hope and to the end.
Verse 12.
That you be not slothful or lazy, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Why? Because some promises don't get fulfilled the first year or the second year or the third year. Even if I will have to wait for 10 years, I will be patient. Even if I will have to wait for 20 years, as long as God has sent it, I will wait for it. Promises get fulfilled not because they were given, but because you are a patient. Through faith and patience, you inherit the promise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father.